Today we are going to go on with this topic. Last week we saw the first stages in the occult path, and now we are going to see the path of initiation, where at the end of it, the person becomes what in theosophy is called a master of the wisdom. The word initiation is used in many movements, and it's used with different meanings. If you are to join Masonry, for example, you have to go through a ceremony of initiation. Or in Hinduism, in Buddhism, if you are going to learn from a particular teacher, they usually have to initiate you. Even in the Theosophical Society, in the past, there was to be a very simple ceremony, and that was a ceremony of initiation into Theosophy. So, and then in the New Age, you hear the word initiation used in many ways, and group initiations and all this. Now, each movement used this word in a particular way. In the way that the Theosophical tradition uses it, initiation means something that happens on the inner planes and that happens to people who have become disciples of a master of the wisdom, have gone through the process of probation that we explored last week, and have been accepted. So, while today we are going to see the different initiations that lead to the stage of a master of the wisdom, that doesn't mean that we are talking about this because it can happen at any time to any of us, in the sense that this is a long path. We are going to see in the next week what most of us should place more attention to in the path of trying to become ready to help the masters. But today I want to show a broad view of this path, just to have the perspective, to know what is supposed to happen in the growth of the soul while treading the occult path. As we said, the occult path is, if you want, an artificial path. It's not the normal, regular, slow path of evolution. It's the quickening of this journey so that the person is able to help in the work of the masters, which is to help humanity. So we are going to see the different stages, and then next week we are going to talk about what can be directly applied to our own life. So there are four initiations in the Theosophical view. The fifth one is when the person becomes a master, and that marks the end of the human evolution. You know, in Theosophy, the idea of evolution is that the divine spark, little by little, first acquires experience in the mineral kingdom, then vegetable, then animals. Then we come to the human kingdom, and there are further kingdoms also. Many philosophies are anthropocentric in the sense that they see the whole worldview is around the human being and what is good for human beings and how we can take advantage of things around, whether it is the environment, other kingdoms, other people. The Theosophical view is not, although of course it places emphasis on the human stage because we are human beings, it's not anthropocentric in the sense that it is actually based on the next stage, how to get to the next stage in evolution, which is, we could call it the superhuman kingdom or whatever you want to call it. And that happens, as I said, when the person attains the fifth initiation. And then there are further initiations that we are not going to deal with. As I said, they belong to a different stage of evolution. So after a person is accepted as a disciple, that person was tested to see if the person had the strength to undergo this process, which is very strenuous. If the person didn't have any hidden unconscious tendencies that could be exploited by the, let's say, by the circumstances. If we have a hidden tendency to do something that is hidden because the circumstances are not appropriate for it to express, so that when that person begins to acquire knowledge or power or whatever it is, then that tendency would flourish. So the period of probation, as we said, is to make sure that most of these tendencies are stimulated, faced, and eradicated. So when the master is happy about it and thinks that it is safe both for the disciple and for the master himself to introduce the aspirant into this first initiation, then there is a ceremony that takes place on the inner planes. As I said, this is not something, none of these initiations are physical. When the person goes to sleep, every person that goes to sleep, consciousness retreats to what is called the astral plane. Some people are unconscious there, very few at this point in evolution, it is said. Some people are conscious, but within a bubble, they are not aware of the environment. They are conscious on the astral plane, but of their own things, their own world that they create, which is not too different from what happens even on the physical plane. Many times people live in their own world, create and interpret everything in terms of their own world. And some people are awake on the astral plane and they have a life there. They have a life, and we do on the astral plane many things that are similar to what we do on the physical plane. You know, it's not that the astral plane is a completely different universe. It's a continuation of what we are here. So it is said if we like to learn, we go to lectures on the astral plane or to learn from people. If we want to help, there are places in where we can help and all these kind of things. So the person that is ready to be initiated, of course, has already a life on the astral plane. That to be aware on the astral plane is something that is necessary. Now, when I say this, I don't mean that the person, when the person wakes up, remembers what he or she was doing on the astral plane. Remembering on the waking consciousness has nothing to do with the development of consciousness on the astral plane. The only thing that makes a difference between a person that remembers and a person that doesn't remember is that there are some connections to be made between the astral body and the physical body. A person may be very little developed spiritually, but if that person is interested in being aware on the astral plane, there are exercises that a person can do to produce these connections. And another person that may be very evolved and have a much richer life on the astral plane may not remember anything when he or she comes back to the body. So the first initiation takes place on the astral plane, and it is said that the person may not even remember what happened. Usually, because we are going to see, the first initiation is something that produces an important change in consciousness, there is some remembrance, or whether the person wakes up with some feeling of something extraordinary have happened, or there is some remembrance, however fragmented. But it could be the case that the person doesn't remember. Now, this is a little dangerous because, you know, people who are prone to fool themselves, they can interpret, they had a nice dream, and then they can say, oh, I received the first initiation. Well, that's inevitable, you know, that happens. And the only person that is hurt by that is a person himself or herself. But the idea is that this happens on the astral plane. The physical consciousness may not have any idea of what is going on. And according to the theosophical writers, there is an actual a series of things that the initiate has to do there. There are teachings, there are actions, there are testings, there are a whole series of things that take time. Sometimes the initiation may take several nights to be accomplished. And basically what one of the things that happens in the first initiation is that the person has a glimpse of the buddhic plane. Remember, in the theosophical view, we have this is the physical plane, then we have the astral plane, which is the plane of the emotions. Then we have the mental plane, which is the plane of mind and thoughts. And then there is the plane of buddhi, which is the spiritual intuition. On that plane, the person can perceive unity. When a person perceives unity, even if that person is, you know, here on the physical plane, but is able to perceive the unity behind things, as many or some enlightened, so-called enlightened people are, that means that person is able to perceive on the buddhic plane, and that perception is being transmitted to the brain. So right now, I'm physically awake here, and I may be aware on the astral plane, not me personally, a person may be aware on the astral plane or on the physical or buddhic or atmic, which is a plane that is on top of the buddhic, on top if we see it as layers. But my point is exactly that. They are not layers, they are all interpenetrating and they are states of consciousness. So the person that is perceiving the unity is on the buddhic plane, even though the person may be physically awake and sitting. But here again, there may be a person that is aware on the buddhic plane and has created these connections, and that awareness is brought to the physical body. And there may be a person that is aware on the buddhic plane, but when the body is asleep, but then when the consciousness comes back to the body, because these connections were not created, that person cannot be aware of the buddhic plane while being awake. So my point here is that all the planes are interpenetrating. They are all different states of consciousness. And there has to be a connection, or we have to create like a connection from plane to plane to be able to remember them. But whether we remember them or not doesn't mean that we have or not the experiences on the inner planes. So coming back to the initiation has place on the astral plane. Then the person has a glimpse of the unity of life on the buddhic plane. This glimpse, that person is helped to expand his or her consciousness to a state that person couldn't do it by himself. Of course, there has to be a preparation to be able to do that. But the idea is that the initiation is something that the person is brought to a particular state of consciousness, which produces a mark in consciousness, and afterwards, the person has to work to establish himself in that state of consciousness. Also, the person is usually taught, because one of the things that happens after the first initiation is that the person will begins to help on the astral plane. Again, some people begin to help on the astral plane much before they are initiated, and they learn about the astral plane before they are initiated. So if that was the case, then there is no need to teach anything about the nature of the astral plane. But if the person doesn't know it, and you know, there are traditions that they don't have any teaching about the astral plane. So if there is a person that belongs to one of these traditions and that person is very pure and wants to help and has no idea of the astral plane, he or she may need to be taught, you know, during the initiation and afterwards. But the mark of the first initiation is this glimpse on the buddhic plane. Now, for this to happen, the preparation, which we are going to see in depth in the next talk, but the preparation brought the person to a state where the personality, that means the physical body, the emotions, and our minds, are already aligned with our soul, with what in theosophy is called the higher ego. The personality doesn't have the power anymore, not absolutely, but for the most part, doesn't have the power to push the soul to go in directions that the soul doesn't want to go. So sometimes it is said that in the first initiation, there is a union between the higher self and the lower self, meaning the higher ego, the higher manas, and the lower manas. So after this initiation, the person little by little has to work on establishing his consciousness at the level of unity. So it is said that there are three obstacles that the person has to remove. One of them is a sense of separateness, of being separate from each other. So little by little, the person starts working on learning to identify with every person and learning to understand where each person is. So to separate the, in Christian terms, the sinner from the sin. Because it's easy to identify with a person that is nice and does good things and all that. But even with the people who are doing things that are wrong, because there was this glimpse of the unity on the buddhic plane, now that person has to be able to put himself or herself in the consciousness of the other person and be able to understand why that other person is doing whatever is doing. So little by little, the sense of judgment and condemnation disappears. Not that the person cannot distinguish between good and evil. On the contrary, the ability to distinguish between what is right and wrong sharpens every time, you know, more and more. There is a very sharp perception even of the subtleties of what is right and wrong, because that person is beginning to realize more and more, you know, all the even the subtle ways in which the personality gets in the way. So that person perceives everything, but at the same time is able to feel himself or herself in the other person and understand what the other person is doing and whatever he or she is doing. And understanding that, there is this sense of compassion. Now, this is not a mental process. A mental process may help, you know, it is said, try to put in the other person's shoes, and that's a mental effort that is necessary. But what we are talking about after the first initiation is an actual feeling through the other person, which the person begins to learn how to do, to be trained into that. So this sense of separateness has to be completely overcome before the second initiation can be taken. Another thing that has to be overcome is doubt. Doubt in the sense of, at this stage we study many things. We study the law of karma, reincarnation, all this is a mental process. We may have, you know, an intuitive knowledge, but still it comes through mental processes to ourselves. And when there are difficulties, we may know a lot of about karma, we may give talks about karma, but then when there are difficulties and something happens to us, many times we are not able to act according to what we know. And then we feel something is unfair when we know that if karma is true, nothing is unfair. So after the first initiation, the person has to get to that point where there is a direct knowledge of this, something that it's not a mental concept anymore. There is a direct knowledge, so there is no doubt. And again, this is not blind belief or blind faith. There is no doubt because the person knows. So that when the person goes through difficulties, for example, it may be difficult to go through suffering, you know, but the person doesn't doubt or you know, think that this is unfair or whatever. And the same with some other basic laws of nature, the idea of reincarnation. Again, we may believe in reincarnation, but we are attached to our body, to this particular personality, and we are afraid of dying. And we are the person that is initiated, to before that person can get the second initiation, has to have known by direct experience that he's not the body, that the reincarnation is a fact, and therefore is not attached to this particular manifestation of himself, which is our personality. So that is what, and the same with several other fundamental laws. Before taking the second initiation, there has to be no doubt about this. There has to be a direct knowledge of it. And there is a third obstacle that is usually described as superstition. You know, one has to be beyond any superstition. And the way it is explained is basically related to religions. The idea that one particular religion is the only path, or one particular method, or one particular meditation, or ceremony. The person, the initiate, has to know that any path is just a tool. None of them, neither the theosophical, nor the Buddhist, is the path. And they are all, you know, different tools that may be better for one person or the other. And he has to be independent of any of them. A ceremony, a meditation, or whatever may help you raise your consciousness to a certain level. But at that point, that person has to be able to do it by himself without having to rely on a particular technique or approach. So that doesn't mean that the person doesn't meditate. But the idea is that instead of being following a technique, the person is using a particular technique. You know, it's like when you are trying to learn to drive, you are very conscious of what you should do. Once you know how to drive, you are not trying to make an effort. You know, you use all that naturally. So that's the third obstacle, the superstition, the idea that one particular path is necessary and is the best. So then we come, when the person could overcome all these things, is ready to take the second initiation. The second initiation is said to take place on the mental plane. Because so far, during all this period, which could take several lives from the first to the second initiation, during all this period, the person was helping on the astral plane and also, little by little, learning to work on the mental plane. So during the second initiation, the consciousness has to be established on the mental plane. So what happens there in that initiation is that the mental body of the person, that means, you know, in theosophical terms, mental body would be like the what we call mind, but what we call mind is a fragment of what the real mind is on the inner planes. You know, it's like our real mind is trying to express through the brain, and the brain is very limited, so it can express only a fragment. The cases of geniuses is because for some reason, when a person begins to develop exclusively in one particular path, be it music, mathematics, or whatever it is, the brain begins to be very, very developed to express that particular quality. So you have these people that, since they are little kids, they have an amazing ability to express certain skill or knowledge. There is a case that I read a few days ago of a kid that everybody thought he was autistic. And then he would stare at the stars for hours, or or look at the cereal spread on the table also for hours. And when his mom saw that he really liked the sky, the night sky, she took him to some place where they were explaining astronomy. He was 3 or 4 years old. And she thought that he was going to be bored. And the speaker there asked the audience, who were for the most part physicists and people like that, or students, so why don't the moons of Mars, or why aren't the moons of Mars round? They are like a potato. So he raised his hand and said, because the mass of the moons are not strong or big enough to generate the gravity to make them round. So everybody was astonished. This kid almost didn't even speak. And he said that he got it from, he would spin a ball and spin it on the floor, and he got the laws of gravitation from that. Of course, that knowledge is there, and we all have that knowledge. That is what our mind is. But our brain, for the most part, blocks all that. In the case of people who life after life, they work on the same line and their brain is more receptive to that, then they show this that seems to be amazing. But on the inner planes, that person is pretty, for the most part, the same as any other person that has a hard time here, with math. Now, usually it is not recommended to generate a development that is so, in one particular line, because that means that many other aspects of the personality are not developed. So most of the geniuses are very unbalanced. But anyway, the idea is that in the second initiation, the mental body begins to expand and grow in a very rapid way. And then that knowledge or that growth, what the initiate has to do is to bring all that knowledge little by little to the brain. As I said, the brain is limited, so it has to be little by little because it puts a lot of strain in the brain. And if it is done in a forceful way, the person may just have a psychological breakdown. But usually during the initiation, there are masters or the master of the person is always regulating the process. Because that's the thing, that this expansion, again, is artificial. The master is directing certain forces to produce that. And if the person is not helped, most people would go mad, for example. So the idea is that during the years, all that knowledge begins to come to the brain. It is at this point that psychic powers, if they were not developed before, they need to be developed. So a person may have the second initiation and have no psychic power at all. Because although we call them powers, they are really not powers, as I said. The only difference between a person that sees on the astral plane and the person that doesn't is the connection between the astral plane and the physical, or the astral body and the physical body. It's not a power that is in consciousness that the person develops. There may be a person that is much more evolved than another one, and as I said, and have no psychic power at all. As we are seeing, a person may have gone through the second initiation and have no psychic power at all, or the person may develop them before initiations. That depends on many things, on karma, on what the natural tendencies of the person are, on what the person did in the past, in what direction the person went and pushed. But at this point, this is necessary because before taking the third initiation, the person has to be able to be aware of the astral and the mental plane while being in the physical consciousness. So that is a requirement before taking the third initiation. And also, it has to do with, in order for all this expansion of the mental body to affect the brain, these connections have to be made. So basically, the main task of the person that received the second initiation is to produce these things, to make the growth in the mental body be expressed through the brain. Now, it is said that this is probably the most dangerous point in the path, and usually because if the person is not very vigilant, this produces a terrible sense of pride. Because suddenly the person is a genius. You know, if many of us may be proud of our little intelligence, our little skill, or because I'm able to run faster than another person and they give me a gold medal, big deal, you know, running faster than the others, or being able to explain something better than some other person, it's not a big deal, or having more memory than another person, yet we are proud. When all this really enlarged perception, knowledge, power begins to express through the personality, there is a possibility that that person, the seed of the lower ego that is always there until the fifth initiation, gets, you know, vitalized, and that person may be taken over by this pride and may fall out of the path. And for some lifetimes, that person will go through, you know, some karmic consequences trying to get back to the path. Because usually when an initiate fails doing some harm, you know, if you have a lot of power and you start using the power wrong, you will do some harm. If you don't have power, you know, even if you do something wrong, it's not much harm that you can do. So this is why it's very important, since the beginning, the very beginning of the path, to be very vigilant about our sense of pride or arrogance or the sense of ego. If you think that you are special, and we have to listen to ourselves, because we all know that this shouldn't be there. So we say, oh, no, I don't want to do this for these reasons, for selfish reasons. I don't want to be recognized, or I don't want to. We all say, I do it to help humanity. We all say it because we read it. Now, that's fine. You can say whatever you want. But if we want to be honest, we have to look inside and really see and check if we really feel that we are different, better, or if we have a spiritual ambition. We have to examine it to realize why that is a mistake since the very beginning. Because if we don't do it, and that remains hidden, and we don't have the luck that karma will put us in a position where that will be exposed, we may get to this point with that seed there, and then it is very difficult to overcome it. I think I have a quote from Leadbeater. He says, the period after taking the second initiation is in many ways the most dangerous of the path, on the path. In nearly all cases, the danger comes through pride. If there is the least tinge of pride in the man's nature, he is in serious risk of a fall. And if he once starts on that line, he will have a terribly hard time getting back again. Nothing but unceasing and increasing vigilance can enable him to pass through this stage successfully. And it must be his constant endeavor to kill out every trace of pride, selfishness, and prejudice. So I think that's one of the main points we have to be careful with, because it is said that the pride is the last thing that one can eradicate completely after, you know, in the fifth initiation. And it is very easy to imagine oneself, you know, advanced, especially when one is advanced. You know, if many times the fact that a person doesn't know that he or she is an initiate is a protection. because that person may begin to think that he or she is different. And it is always said, the difference between an initiate and a person that is not initiate is very small compared to the difference between an adept and the initiate. Because the adept is a completely different kingdom. I said in one of the previous talks, it's like saying a better dog compared to a dull dog, and that compared to a human being. You know, it's like the better dog thinks now that he's a human being because he's a little brighter than the dull dog. So I'm putting it in these terms because it's like that. You know, we are very prone to think that we are great or we are meant to do great things, to save the world, to change this or that. And the true idea is that we are just like a brick in a building that is being built. So we have to learn how to fit in the spot that was assigned to us, not to take over the brick, not to be brighter than the brick that is next to us. Because if there is a brick that is brighter than the rest, it throws off the harmony of the thing. So it's just to be the brick that has to go in that particular place, with whatever shape is meant for that, and not to be better than anybody else. So once the person works on this and is able to bring down all this to the physical brain and all this power, knowledge, ability is successfully used for the help of humanity, that person may take the third initiation. It is usually said that after the second initiation, the person may take the third one in the next incarnation. It doesn't take usually that long, and unless a person falls out of the path and then there are several incarnations to come back. But usually after the second initiation, it is said that in the next incarnation, the person may take the third, and the third and the fourth are usually taken in the same incarnation. After the fourth initiation, the person doesn't have to reincarnate anymore, although they usually do because the idea of being initiated is to remain in the world to help humanity. But the person is not pushed by the law of reincarnation to be reborn unconsciously, as we all are. So the idea is that once the second initiation happens, if all goes well, there is only one more initiation until the person gets to the point that is free from the cycle of reincarnations. As I said, the person keeps on incarnating, but just to help the world. So the third initiation, just as the second initiation works on the mental body, which is is on the lower mental plane, the third initiation works at the level of the causal body, which is what we could call our soul, the soul. You know, the mental body, the emotional body, the physical body, they all are part of the personality. After we die, the physical body is dissolved, the astral body or emotional is dissolved, and the mental body is dissolved. And then consciousness retreats to the causal body or the soul. So all these initiations were working at the level of the personality. Now, in the third initiation, it works on the causal body, the soul, to begin to make a stronger connection to the spirit, the universal spirit that we all share, to Atman in theosophical terms. So pretty much similarly as the second initiation, the effect on the mental body is now the effect on the causal body. But now this development is far, far higher than what the physical brain can express. You wouldn't notice the difference between a second initiation and a third initiation in a person, because at least that's what it is described. What takes place is far beyond the possibility of the brain at this point of evolution of expressing. And then once this happens, the third initiation happens and there is this effect on the causal body, there is not a too long time until the fourth initiation, as I said. It is usually taken in the same lifetime. But the period between the third and the fourth initiation is said to be the most difficult one, not the most dangerous. We said, you know, the most dangerous usually is the second, but it's the one that has the last trial and the biggest trial, which in Christianity is represented with the crucifixion and the resurrection. The before and after the fourth initiation, there is this, the initiate has to be able to die to absolutely everything but the Atmic consciousness. So he has to be able to let go of absolutely everything. And it is said that is the real dark night of the soul, the ultimate dark night of the soul. As we said in the previous talk, this happens, you know, all these initiations, you can say there are reflections on our daily life, which are not real initiations in the sense of happening on the astral plane with masters, they are producing it. But similar processes may be reproduced during our process of growth. So there are also smaller dark nights of the soul, if you want to call it like that. But the real dark night of the soul is the one that happens right before the fourth initiation. And let me read how Bezant and Leadbeater describe it. Bezant says, between the third initiation and the fourth, there is that gulf of silence where the disciple hangs alone in the void with nothing on earth to trust to, nothing in heaven to look to, no friend whose heart can be relied upon, nay, even the vision of the Supreme blurred and dimmed. And she says, Leadbeater says, always at this stage, there is suffering, physical, astral, and mental. Always there is a condemnation by the world and the apparent failure. Always there is a splendid triumph upon the higher planes, which, however, remains unknown to the outer world. What they say is that it always entails to face a massive attack or reproval or from the world. And this happens also on the inner planes. It is said that before the fourth initiation, the person stays absolutely alone, and because he has to be able to stand in what he or she essentially is without being influenced at all by the external, on the physical or on the inner planes. So Bezant says, he sees his beloved flee, sees himself betrayed, denied, rejected, until at last, upon the cross of agony, he is held up for all men to mock at, for all men to despise, sees at last no friend, but only a ring of enemies triumphant. And she's comparing this with what happened with Jesus. She says this is a representation of the fourth initiation. And he hears them saying, he saved others, and himself he cannot save. That's what the soldiers were saying of Jesus. The deepest truth of all. And the initiate utters at the last cry of the breaking heart, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Which is what Jesus is supposed to have said on the cross. And then she says that, but when the great darkness comes down and nothing can be seen, then arises the light of spirit in the human heart. And then through the darkness are heard the final words of triumphant success. And this is a very famous word or phrase in the occult environment, which is consummatum est, which means it is finished. Because when the person went through that and could stand on his or her own feet, let's say, then that's the casting off of any kind of dependence on anything that is not the pure being. So Leadbeater says this not only happens on the physical plane. He says, although painful, an initiate is able to stand in the world even if people, you know, are attacking him, even if his friends are betraying him or running away, as you know, Peter denied Jesus and all the disciples flew when he was taken. But he says this happens also on the inner planes, and especially the person has to or is put in what in theosophy is called avicii. Avicii is similar to what in Christianity says they call hell, but nothing like that. So the idea is that, you know, in Christianity they say, what do they say? Jesus was crucified, he descended to hell, and then he was resurrected from hell. I always thought, why Jesus? He was the Son of God. How come he went to hell? Now, Leadbeater says, he has also to experience for a moment the condition called avicii, which means the waveless, that which is without any vibration. The state of avicii is not, as has been popularly supposed, some kind of hell, but it is a condition in which the man stands absolutely alone in space and feels cut off from all life, even from that of the Logos. At this point, the initiate had already seen the unity of life, he felt, but at this point there is a completely cut off. In some other writings they say it's the most awful experience to feel you are absolutely isolated from everything in the universe, because it's the exact opposite to the truth. The truth is that we are one with everything. And they say the fact that the human consciousness has the greatest difficulty to deal with is a feeling of being cut off, which we can see on the physical plane also. You know, when a person is isolated, how this produces a psychological imbalance. So he says, it is without doubt the most ghastly experience that it is possible for any human being to have. It is said to last only for a moment, but to those who have felt its supreme horror, it seemed an eternity, for at that level, time and space do not exist. And he says, some have collapsed before this terrible test and have had to go back and begin over again their climb towards a higher initiation. Not that they lose the previous initiations, but, you know, they have to, that means that they didn't have enough strength to take this last step. So he says, but for the man who can stand firm through its awful nightmare, it is indeed a wonderful experience. So it is said that after, when the person, you know, can stand that experience, then there is the complete dropping of any identification with anything that is not the universal Atman. And then the consciousness of the initiate, in all these three initiations, the initiate was little by little going higher and higher on the buddhic plane, meaning perceiving deeper and deeper the unity of all life. So in the fourth initiation, the person enters what in Buddhism is called nirvana. And in the theosophical view, this is the atmic plane. So there is nirvana. You know, in Buddhism, they say nirvana is the annihilation of consciousness. In the Theravada Buddhism, they say consciousness disappears just as when you blow out a candle and the flame disappears. In the theosophical view, it is seen, yeah, that is true regarding all the lower vehicles. And this is what happens, you know, in this state of absolute void. But the consciousness of the nirvanic consciousness, which is what is real, is retained. So the initiate that went through the fourth initiation now is aware on the nirvanic plane and has to begin to ascend through all the subplanes of the nirvanic plane, as he did on the buddhic plane. It is said that up to the fourth initiation, seven incarnations more or less are necessary. Of course, each person is different. This is just like saying human life lasts 80, 90 years, you know. So it is said that seven incarnations are usually necessary for to go from discipleship to the fourth initiation. And then there are seven incarnations necessary between the fourth and the fifth initiation. So the fourth is like the middle point, because the fifth initiation is when the person becomes an adept, a master. So up to the fourth initiation, as we saw, there can be a failure, which is always temporary. But even at the boundary or the brink of the fourth initiation, the person may retreat. But it is said that after the fifth initiation, then there is no danger. That's the end of it. And let me read a brief description of the fifth initiation, and with this we will finish. I think this was Anibesan that says, the fifth initiation, that of the adept, is a final step that makes him a superman. Aseka, as the Buddhists call him, because he has no more to learn and has exhausted the possibilities of the human kingdom of nature. A Jivan Mukta, as the Hindu speaks of him, a liberated life, a free being, because his will is one with the universal will, with the one without a second. He stands ever in the light of Nirvana, even in his waking consciousness, should he choose to remain on earth in a physical body. So this is what we call masters of the wisdom, those who have attained the fifth initiation and have realized what we are in truth, this Atmic Self. Okay, so is there any comments or questions about this? There are many things, of course, to say. If anybody wants to read more about this, they can read The Masters and the Path by Leadbeater, or Initiation by Annie Besant, or there are some other books also.
I just would like you to clarify, when you talked about the seven reincarnations between the first and the fourth, when we're reborn, we don't know, we have to go through being a child and a teenager and all that. So it's not like we jump until after.
And although this is not very clear, although this is not spelled out, to me it's clear that in each incarnation, you have to take the initiations again. If you had a third initiation in one, you incarnate again and you go through the first, second, and third initiation again. But that may happen, you know, in a couple of years. You go through a period of probation also. You have to undo the whole thing, but the period of probation may be, you know, a few months or even a few days. But you have to be under the forces that are related to probation, the first initiation. It's like a recapitulation. And yes, on each incarnation, you have to go through all that. After the third initiation, where the person already has to connect all the different bodies and has the continuity of consciousness, I guess it's easier to remember who you are, to remember your past and all that. Though probably most people don't even remember it when they are children. But during the first stages, yeah, you are just a normal person.
So what initiation was KH at?
We don't know, but the speculation is that he was in the fifth initiation, and while the letters were being sent to Sinet, we know that he went into a retreat to take an initiation. And I think Leadbeater and Besant, they say that he took the sixth initiation, which means that they, well, this is a whole different subject, but there is the idea of the seven rays of consciousness, and they represent like the seven types of monads that are in the Logos. And there is an adept that is the head of one of the rays, or these adepts have to have the sixth initiation. So it seems that that's the initiation that he went through.
Isabella online asks, do we have to be reborn in the physical body to finish cycles or initiations, or could it be continued on other planes after death?
No, it is necessary even to the attainment of Buddhahood to be incarnated, to have a physical body. It is said with the Buddha that he was already a Buddha on the inner planes, in the sense that he already had the expansion of consciousness he needed, or the realization of truth, but he had to take a physical body and do it on the physical plane, because all the vehicles of consciousness have to be affected. As I said, any of us on the astral plane right now are far wiser than we are on the physical plane. So what is needed is to bring all that as much as it is possible to the physical body. There is a limit to what the physical body can really express at this point in evolution. We are only halfway in the evolution of the system. You know, when we saw rounds and chains, we are in the fourth round of evolution out of seven. So we did 3.5. So we are at the middle point. So the physical body, the physical matter, is not able to express all the potentialities of the spirit at all. By the end of the evolutionary scheme, it may express much more, but at this point, it doesn't. But anyway, we need to go through every initiation while incarnated.
So does humanity on the whole, as it passes through the chains, does it go through initiations? Or is it an initial individual thing?
Yeah, no, it doesn't need to go through initiations, although it goes through all the same stages. You know, remember, the first initiation is when the person has a glimpse of the buddhic plane, usually the lowest subplane of the buddhic plane. Now, this may happen even before initiation. To some people, it's not that you need the initiation to be aware on the buddhic plane. If you follow the regular path, at some point, you will become aware on the buddhic plane and without any initiation. But the thing is that with the initiation, you do it faster. So there are mystics that without being disciples of a master and without going through any initiation, and even just because they had such a pure love for the deity, and the buddhic plane is reflected on the emotional plane. So a deep love and devotion can make you jump to the buddhic plane and have a glimpse of it. So during the process of evolution, all humanity will become aware of the lowest subplane of the buddhic, then the higher, and then eventually get to nirvana. But that will take 3 more rounds. And the idea is that by the end of the seventh round, which is trillions of years, most humanity will be, or actually I think all humanity has to get there to get to be aware on the nirvanic plane. Now this, with the initiations, instead of happening in trillions of years, happen in 14 incarnations. You know, so that's why the initiation, that's what the initiation means. But anybody can get there naturally.
Is there any particular age within the physical body that the initiations could start?
No, there isn't. In the theosophical, you know, history, we have some people who were initiated when they were very young, and people who were initiated when they were older. It is usually said that we need, it depends on how the person is, because any initiation produces a strain in the body. So as we are going to see then in our next talk, the person has to have a good health in the sense of being strong. Good health, you know, that person may have some illness or something, but if the person is strong, then it would be okay, and has to be psychologically strong to resist the strain. So theoretically, there is no limitation. Usually, you know, because of the vitality, there are some mystics that they say before you are 40 years old, your body is not ready for these things, for example. Krishnamurti mentioned that. He said, nobody can meditate before they are 40 years old. Really meditate. You know, we play with meditation. We train ourselves in meditation. And there is this other mystic that I sometimes quote, John Toller, and he says something similar. You cannot have these mystical experiences before you are 40 years old. But that may be like a general thing that happens because we have examples of, you know, Ramana Maharshi was 16 when he had this thing. I think he was 50-something when he had this vision. So there is no rule.
How did the process begin? Meaning, early on, monads are going through mineral before they turn human. Right now, what we're talking about is there are masters that bring people up and initiate them. How did the process begin before there were masters?
There is always help from other systems. I don't know what happened in the first chain of world in the universe, if there was a first one, because usually it is said this has no beginning and no end. So it's kind of asking, if you go to the ultimate questions, it's like asking who created God or what was before. But if you restrict it to a particular system, when the evolution of the Earth begins and the monads begin to grow on to evolve on Earth, there are adepts and masters from other planetary chains that come and help the new monads on the Earth. So, for example, it is said that even during the beginning of the physical humanity, what in Theosophy is called the Third Root Race, actually many of these adepts that do not belong to Earth, they incarnated and they were the kings and pharaohs and druids that taught humanity agriculture and medicine and this and that. In the Theosophical view, humanity was taught. It's not that they learned little by little, eating a little fruit, so this person died, and they say, okay, let us not eat this, which would be very difficult because you need several people dying from that fruit until somebody figures out and say, oh, they all, you know. So in the Theosophical view, all this was taught. It could develop, you know, by itself, but the idea is that there is this help, and because of this help, evolution is faster than it would be if there were no help. So it is said that the Buddha, Gautama Buddha, is the first human Buddha that we have, because before him, no human being had attained the level to be a Buddha. So the one that was fulfilling the role of a Buddha was a monad from another planet. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, it's an alien that came in a UFO and is ruling the adepts. The monads just incarnate in human forms. The monads are, you know, even they are omnipresent, the monads of this kind of people. So for all we can tell, they are human beings, but they were evolving in previous systems that were more advanced, that studied evolution before the Earth.
Yeah.
There is one over there in on the internet.
One? Oh, over here.
Isabella asks again, are the autistic people a sign of human evolution? They seem to be more mental.
I don't know. In this particular case of this kid, he is now 14. I don't remember his name. He's now 14 and he is taking a PhD in physics or a master in physics. He was like that, and everybody thought that he was autistic because he would stare at the shades on the carpet, and probably his brain was processing patterns and this and that, you know. But he could come out of it and communicate, and now he's a normal, you know, kid. I don't know if that is the case of every person that is autistic. And, you know, geniuses are not normal cases. Now, I'm not meaning they are better or worse. Simply, they are not normal cases. It's just like a person, you know, with a lot of muscles, and that's not a normal person. That person worked on his body specifically to produce that. Not that there is anything wrong with that, but it's not a normal person. So geniuses are people who worked in a particular aspect of their being with exclusion of everything else. If autistic people are basically this kind of people, you know, that could be the case, but I don't know that would mean that they are more evolved or less evolved. Now, I'm just sharing my process of thinking. I don't know the answer. That's, you know, what I would think. Diane?
I have witnessed, he's not autistic in Brooklyn. My friend's grandson. He is only maybe 6 years old. He can process arithmetic at a sixth grade level. I've seen him talk about numbers in my own presence. I could not believe. And yet, he would have a temper tantrum right after that and be a five-year-old again. So there are circumstances. Sometimes we don't really know what the...
Yeah, and many times it has to do, for the most part, with the physical brain. You have a person that you know is not able to function in the world, and the problem is in the brain. When that person goes to sleep and is on the astral plane, he or she is a normally perfect person, but the connection between the mental body and the physical body is disrupted for some reason, karmic reason. So when we have a person that has a mental problem, and that doesn't mean that only the outermost coat of that person is not working, but not the person itself. But again, that has a karmic purpose. And then as we said, if we overdevelop one aspect of ourselves, in that aspect we will be different. And in all the other aspects, we will be just like anybody else, or sometimes worse than anybody else, because we pay less attention to that.